Hello, and welcome to part six of the lectures on logic for the class Philosophy A to Deductive Logic. With part six, we're going to start the section on fallacies, informal fallacies in particular, which is going to encompass chapter three, and I've asked you to read all of chapter three. Now, the next five lectures, this one included, are going to be on the subject of informal fallacies. The largest group of the entire course, if you recall, chapter one got two lectures, chapter two got two lectures, now we've got five lectures, chapter three. May I explain why? Because in part, getting these down is a matter of lore rather than system. I'll explain that presently. But probably most importantly, detecting fallacies is maybe the most practical thing that a non-specialist student is going to take away from a course. What did Oliver Wendell Holmes say about Greek and Latin? It is not important to know Greek, Latin. It's important to have forgotten them. And that's true, I think, of a lot of subjects. Now, yes, it's important to have forgotten quite a lot of things, how to do syllogisms, for example, all the details, all the kinds of syllogisms, how to do Venn diagrams. These are things one can always look up. Although, an educated person will take away from the study of logic the notion that validity is very important and that validity is a matter of form and not just of content. You can have true conclusions from arguments that are really formally bad and informally bad too, as we'll see. But the main thing I think that will stick from a course like this, should stick, is basically the ability to develop and maintain a bullshit detector. You hear someone say something, or you hear yourself about to say something. By the way, point I'm going to take up in this lecture, detecting fallacies isn't just always a matter of catching the other guy out. It's a matter of catching me out as well, and realizing, hey, this is a bad argument. It's wrong to do this. Shouldn't do this. Nip it in the bud. So you're going to have many occasions in life to remember the fallacies. That's why I think it's important to devote a great deal of time to them. Perhaps the most
important. I'm still waiting to hear what your point is.
Right. You'll find yourself saying, as Mr. Hitchens says, what's your point? You don't have an argument here. Okay, so let's start with the definition. A fallacy, we saw this before in chapter one. Any defect in an argument that consists of something other than merely false premises. I mean, having false premises is one way to fail, if you recall the talk about formal deductive syllogisms. Having false premises is one way to fail at having an argument, one way to fail at soundness, but of course, possible also to fail by having an argument form, which is not valid. And we're going to extend that notion here to the informal fallacies, other than merely false premises. That is, there could be problems with argument that, again, don't have to do simply with truth and falsehood. So this is indeed a broad definition. It covers both the formal fallacies, which we've looked at already, and the informal ones, which we will now take up. A fallacy is any problem that lies elsewhere than in the content. However, we drew a distinction before for the formal fallacies between form and content, Naomi and her skeleton. Here's a syllogism, it's a formal argument, the basic form of the deductive argument, if you recall. All poodles are flowers, therefore all poodles are dogs. Well, nothing wrong with the conclusion there, except the way you get to the conclusion is a problem. And again, beyond the true content of the truth or falsity, at all of the content of the premise, the conclusion, and see if it's really a good argument to get you there. It is possible the content of a conclusion to be true, and still the argument is messed up. If you divide 16 by 4 and you do so by the method simply eliminating the sixes, you get the right answer. Just happened to. Any defect in an argument that consists of something other than merely false premises. So with the formal fallacies, we can eyeball the form. And after a while, you get used to this. You say, affirming the consequent, I've seen that bad boy before. I already know that is an invalid form. Or if you need to, you could always test it. Remember the universal test for validity, substitution instances. And formal fallacies could be detected by mere inspection. You can eyeball the form, so to say. But this is not so with informal fallacies because there is no form. They could be detected through having acquired a working familiarity with their basic types, which is what we're going to do in these six lectures. what you're going to do. Since there's no form, there's no syllogism involved, it isn't a simple matter of eyeballing. Informal fallacies employ inappropriate methods, but even though these are not formal, these are informal, it's still important to see what those things are in order to avoid them. So again, other than merely false premises refers to the method of reasoning, whether formal or informal, it's something else other than content. Okay, that's some good news and some bad news. Bad news is, informal fallacies are going to be harder than the formal fallacies. They cannot be learned systematically. There's no handy test for validity. And I tried to show you along the way as a supplement to Mr. Hurley's text, some basic techniques, including the Punnett squares and so forth, whereby you can make this a little more systematic. But that's appropriate for the formal ones. It is not possible for the informal ones because, whereas the formal ones are a matter of system to begin with, the informal ones are more a matter of what we could call lore. Think about learning the language and having to decline verbs, to conjugate verbs. This is what we're going to do here. It's not unlike that. You get a paradigm example, you say, okay, I have the paradigm in mind, now I'm going to apply it, in this case. With the system stuff, the teacher can help greatly. I hope that I did that to some extent, showing rational properties, suggesting shortcuts, rules of thumb, mnemonic devices, all that. With this stuff, though, the student just have to get this under your belts. The teacher can only help so far, but no further. That's the bad news. The good news is there are some rules of thumb, and Mr. Hurley's text is particularly good on these. For example, as also with the formal fallacies, if an argument type, the straw man, appeal to unqualified authority, so on and so forth, provides an unreliable method in one instance, it's going to be unreliable in all others. Well, that's the kind of commonality. Secondly, there are groups of fallacies which share common characteristics, which are really five groups. We'll go through them. But thirdly, any argumentative move which says, in effect, shut up or stop reasoning, is going to be fallacious. The ad hominem is particularly at fault here. I'm going to spend time with the ad hominem. And fourth, informal fallacies always have limits. Whether any argumentative move is actually fallacious or not depends on whether it actually impedes good reasoning. We're going to see this in a number of instances, most notably in what used to be called the appeal to authority fallacy. We don't call it that anymore. We call it the appeal to unqualified authority because it turns out there are some authorities that are dependable and some that are not, or more, some less so. So it's very important to think about when you're deciding whether some authoritative statement is really credible or not, to bear that in mind. So again, as I said, Mr. Hurley's text is very good at grouping the informal fallacies. Here has five groups, which we'll work through systematically. Now, it's important to recognize that if I'm tempted to use the informal fallacy of affirming the consequent, then I might want to think twice. It's important likewise to recognize if I'm tempted to use the informal fallacy of ad hominem, I also might want to think twice. So there's a common point to looking at both of these in their turn. Fallacy is an unreliable argument strategy. It makes formal invalidity invalid is that it's unreliable. Remember, still for me, once and you're a thief, once a thief, always a thief. Even 99 times out of 100, you haven't stolen from me. If you do it the 100th time, that's a problem. So if an argument form is unreliable now, it's going to be unreliable next time. Once invalid, once fallacious, always fallacious. There is a difference, of course, between the formal and the informal. One can eyeball the formal, they have a form. The informal fallacies just make one work a little bit more. On the other hand, don't make too much of this difference. It's one of degree. The fallacies of either sort have patterns. Patterns can be recognized. Patterns can be avoided. Obvious of a pattern. Patterns recur. Because this is so, it's all the more important to sensitize oneself to identify their occurrence so as to protect oneself there. Recurrence, which will be inevitable. If you train yourself to detect, say, the fallacy of affirming the consequent, it's not necessary to reinvent the wheel every other time it's encountered and demonstrate why it's invalid. The same is true for the informal fallacies. But let me give you first, before we jump into this, a word of caution and how not. Here's something I pulled off the internet. This is very popular. It shows up in a lot of different sites. The logic gods, Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle sitting up there in, I guess, Olympian heaven. The logic gods decree thou shalt not commit logical fallacies. This has even been issued on a poster you can put in your dorm room, I guess. I would say beware of this. This is the kind of thing I would call logico-fundamentalism. Yes, there is a thing. See this on other, you know, other websites. Well, the Ten Commandments of Rational Debate. Logico-fundamentalism. Yeah, logic is not just one more cult. If you're familiar with conservative religion, you've probably heard the term proof texting. And this is when the fundamentalists, let's say, will take the Bible out and open it to a passage and, you know, read the passage and say, you know, see, I've proven my case. You know, sometimes it involves some Bible thumping as well. One of the obnoxious things done by actual fundamentalists is just playing the Bible like a trump card. As the above definition of proof texting notes, its vices include attention to rhetorical but not logical success, winning an argument rather than making a case, and they illegitimately appeal to authority, and as well as trumping to check. That suggests one of the hallmarks of the fallacy. So beware of that kind of thing. Beware of logical fundamentalism. Paying attention to logical fallacies, first of all, isn't just one big game of gotcha. Logic students should not trump like Bible thumping professors try to trump. And logic is not supposed to be preaching, you know. The whole notion of thou shalt not is just wrong. You know, it's all too easy to become defined by the idea you oppose or really think you oppose. This is cognitive victimization, and it's never a good idea, you know. Transgressiveness, when I dignify what I denigrate. David Jurowski said of Paul Feyerabend, like the angry ex-communist who thinks he has changed his mind because he has changed from love to hatred of the dogma, which still fixates his thinking, there is a certain sort of logic-minded zealotry too easily passes over into its opposite. I'll take as a case in point a group of folks known as the New Atheists. There are more than four of them, but these are the four main ones, the four horsemen of the apocalypse, as they're called. Richard Dawkins, who's an evolutionary biologist and quite learned and worth reading on lots of topics. Christopher Hitchens, last of the late Christopher Hitchens, a very incisive spokesman who doesn't put up with any crap. Sam Harris, who is talking these days about the problems of moral relativism, and Daniel Dennett, who has done actually lots of things in philosophy, but he's also on the lecture circuit now. He's done mind and brain, that kind of thing. He's also on the lecture circuit about religion. And one could ask the question about this new atheism. Is it religious or is it itself a faith-based movement? Now that was put to Richard Dawkins, and he got very, 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 very militant on the subject. How dare you call me a fundamentalist? Passion for passion, he said, evangelical Christian and I may be evenly matched, but we are not equally fundamentalist. True scientist, however passionately he may believe in evolution, for example, knows exactly what would change his mind. Evidence. The fundamentalist knows that nothing will. So there's a rebuttal to that. Whereas Bill Maher says, atheism is a religion like abstinence is a sexual position. That's an interesting analogy. Dawkins says a fundamentalist will never change their beliefs. Maybe. There are ex-fundamentalists, though. There are people who have changed their beliefs. This does not address similarities in preachiness. For example, I've listened to organized atheists meet organized fundamentalists, and sometimes it's hard to tell which. I can close my eyes and not be sure. You atheists are more fundamentalist than we Christians because you spend more time believing what you believe than we spend doing what we do. Argument. Personally, I find atheists just as annoying as fundamentalist Christians. Oh, well, the important thing is you found a way to be superior to both. Fundamentalists have their 10 commandments, so secular humanists need their 10 commitments. This is a poster put out by the secular humanists. Sometimes, yeah, one has a hard time telling which side is which. One must wonder, I think, whether organized atheism is not simply one more sectarian Protestant denomination. As Bertie Russell pointed out a long time ago, there are Protestant atheists and there are Catholic atheists, and they differ, but sectarian. Santayana satirized this before. There are Catholic atheists. There is no God. Or perhaps we could say low church atheists screw tape once even the demons disbelieve. And of course, there's the high church. And as Alistair McIntyre says, it is the creed of the English that there is no God, and it is wise to pray to him from time to time. So the boundary between believers and atheists, religious believers and atheists, may not be quite so firm. Militant fundamentalists and militant secularists alike seem to revel in playing gotcha on the topic of logical fallacies. Fundamentalists accuse secularists of circular reasoning. Here's a tract that Protestant fundamentalists give out, even Protestant fundamentalists, done by a fellow named Jack Chick, who's made a number of these over the years, and some of them quite well known. Atheists accuse theists of the straw man fallacy. That's very common. You see memes on the internet to that effect. And you could put together a virtual algorithm for how to win it gotcha against religious belief. You want to pause and be here. But religious believers have their versions too. You know, where science has been wrong, and this is all the scientific theories that have been rejected. And there are many over the history of science. Against the column where Christianity has been proven wrong. Nothing here, sucker. So who's number one now? And there's a famous one, the USC professor in the chalk. The story goes, I just mentioned, I think, as a USC professor was a militant atheist, and he lectured to his students. And then at the end of the semester, none of them were religious believers anymore. Is anybody, can anybody prove God's existence? And says, well, I'll prove God's non-existence. Nobody stood up when he did that because it was kind of intimidating, but I'll prove God's not a piece of chalk. If God's active, he'll stop this piece of chalk from breaking. He drops the chalk, which he's done in, so goes, he's done in his class any number of semesters. But this time, it hits the cuff of his trousers and rolls off and hits the floor. It's not broken. And he goes screaming out of the room. And then this fundamentalist student gets up and so I realized he'd been wrong all along and ran screaming like a little girl in the end. Actually, this has been cracked down. By the way, a good resource is the website called snopesnopes.com. Lots of modern urban legends floating around. Some of them sound plausible. Some of them sound too wild to be true. Sometimes the ones that are too wild to be true turn out to be true. When I was putting the slide together, I noticed apparently, in 2022, Kentucky Fried Chicken announced a special for in commemoration of Kristallnacht. Kristallnacht was the beginning of the Holocaust. It was a night when there was widespread anti-Semitic violence. Windows were smashed or shops and so on and so forth. And, that just sounds too crazy to be plausible, but it turned out to be true. Snopes checked it out, and there was it. I checked out this one about the USC professor in the talk, and it turns out that's a legend that goes back to the 1920s, and nobody in the philosophy department at USC, remembers anybody remotely like this, and don't remember that sort of incident, and, so it's not in the realm of fact. And as for what logic doesn't do, there are lots of videos on YouTube in which the speaker destroys the opponent with superior logic. I just looked at a number of them there. Ben Shapiro often, is touted as being the guy who does this. Well, just as logic is not merely another cult. It's not some sort of wizardry either. Got a newsflash for you. The word destroy is not a logical operator, not a logical operation. Logic is not going to destroy any argument. A better argument might. But logic itself. No, remember, logic is a matter of form, not content. Yes, it's important that you know them, but you also need some content in there. Logic by itself does not guarantee truth. Logic by itself does not guarantee anything else of substance. content. You still got to make your votes. So is it possible to be fundamentalist about logic? Well, you know, Jerry Falwell on his side and Christopher Hitchens on his side seem to play that same game. Hitchens may not beat Falwell at holier than thou, but they're on a level playing field when it comes to correcter than thou. Logical fundamentalism is the application of logical fallacy labels in an unthinking, knee-jerk fashion. Yes, it's important to avoid fallacies, but there are reasons for this. It's not just one more thou shalt not commandment. Again, logic is not. Here's a good rule of thumb. A fallacy is a fallacy only because it impedes forward progress. If it does that, if any of these labeled fallacies we're gonna look at does, if any of them does that, then okay, you got a problem, but maybe it doesn't impede argument, then you do. Graham's hierarchy of disagreement. This is interesting. A pyramid going from the least useful at the bottom to the most useful at the top, starting with name calling, some gnat's hat, the ad hominem, moving up through responding to tone, moving into contradiction, and then into the top three, which are getting in the right ballpark for us: counter argument, refutation, being the central point in particular of an. Moving up the disagreement hierarchy makes people less mean. Maybe it'll also make them happier, more happy as well. Good argument ranks fairly high on the hierarchy of disagreement. Fallacy ranks lower on the hierarchy of disagreement. And of course, there's contradiction in the middle. Remember a contradiction from Monty Python argument clinic. Fallacy is a fallacy because, but only insofar as it impedes good reasoning. Deciding when and if this is so requires the application of good judgment. There is room for debate, and one should avoid just missing the point. We're going to consider examples of this below. For instance, I mentioned the unqualified authority fallacy. We could also mention the straw man. Sometimes what appear to be straw men are not straw men. Slippery slopes, sometimes what appear to be slippery slopes are not, in fact, and the examples go on. So, newsflash, logic is not just one big game. Gotcha. As Popper says, I think this is wise, aim of argument or discussion should not be victory, but progress. Just as logic is not merely one more cult, it's not just one more police either. Here's a meme from the internet. This is Fallacy Man of the Logic Police. Whenever someone is illogical, I will be there. Whenever someone is wrong, I will tell them why. I mentioned in the chapter on language that one of the reasons logical positivism has an echo effect is that the guys that write the logic textbooks are old enough to remember logical positivism, and some of them are old enough to remember TV shows from the 1950s, The Lone Ranger or Zorro. That's obviously the Fallacy Man is modeled. Vigilantes who bring justice where ordinary processes do it. Yes, and there's Logic Man at work. Guy says, yeah, but Glenn Beck is an idiot. You shouldn't listen to anything he says. Ad hominem, ad hominem, ad hominem. There's Captain Owl, Captain Logic Owl, sorry, of Excelsior College, who swoops in whenever Mr. Fallacy, that's the guy, the villain there in the black cape and black top hat.
Ooh, Mr. Trouble never hangs around when he hears this mighty sound.
Yeah, it's another superhero from the 1950s, Mighty Mouse. Okay, so logicians are not the tone police. They're not there to catch every little slip of the tongue and so forth. They're not there to be swooped in like Mr. Logic Owl. Imagine what the world would be like if we lived in this universe. Okay, middle school students, first Tuesday in February, that means by law and custom, we must spend the morning reading through the Wikipedia article list of common misconceptions so you can spend the rest of your life being a little less wrong. The guest at every party you'll ever attend, thank us in advance. Yeah, right. tone police fit about in the middle of that hierarchy of disagreement, but better to be toward the top. When the sage points at the moon, the fool looks at the finger. Yeah. Instead of paying attention to the substance of an argument, you know, you can pay attention to the tone in which it's voiced, but that's not fairly an improvement. Just why is it that logic is not one big game of gotcha? Go back to what we considered about the nature of knowledge, and I refer you again, if you haven't seen it already, to some of the lectures in the intro course, but part of which I summarized in the first course. Why do we need argument? Well, we do because so much of human knowledge is not analytic, but synthetic. That analytic-synthetic distinction is very important. Very little is cut and dried, much is rebuttable. So to avoiding fallacies isn't just some mechanical cure-all, it's something that rather requires some sustained thought, it requires some nuance. True or false, 1 + 1 = 5. Well, this is pretty obvious. Insisting on repeating this is verges on stupidity. The earth is flat. Well, that's also false, but it's not analytically obvious why this is false. It's false because it so happens to be false. Huh? Masturbation is morally wicked, and the Pope says so ex cathedra. Hmm? Hens have teeth and horses have toes. Professor Stephen Jay Gould says so, which he does, by the way. Hens, teeth, and horses' toes. One of these claims is badly reasoned. It's fallacious. Which one and why, though, is not analytically obvious. I want to spend some time from the beginning addressing, and I'm going to come back to this in order of the grouping of fallacies, but I want to talk about this at first. Ad hominem. And I've tried to, for each of the fallacies, I've tried to get a warning sign. So my warning sign here is one guy kicking the other guy in the nuts. Yeah, that pretty much captures the ad hominem. Are we living in an era of ad hominem? Can there be an aspect of fashion or timeliness to logical fallacies? Some fallacies do seem more popular than others. Different political factions have their preferred fallacies. We're going to go back to this another point, but a study of the Croatian parliament turned up, you know, the fact, first of all, that some fallacies are more common than others. Ad populum is the most common in a democratic legislature. You would expect that. The ad hominem is a close second, and you can rank the others. Fallacies also differ by parties. The left wing tends to prefer ad populum, the right wing tends to prefer ad hominem, and so on and so forth. By the way, I want to challenge that notion. You know, that works for the Croatian parliament. I'm not sure it works across the board. In political rhetoric today, ad hominem is taken not to be so much a fallacy as it is a positive way of life. And you see, again, you know, dueling memes on the internet. Here's the conservative Republican brain and why it fails as a brain. Common sense lobe is pretty small. And there's the socialist brain of a liberal Democrat. Again, why liberals are mentally deficient in the way that conservatives are said to be in the other one. Different sides converge on the belief that there are no opponents, only enemies, and these are deplorable persons. And the Democrats say the Republicans, you bunch of inbred mouth breathers, mental deficit, callous, privileged, greedy pigs, moral deficit, and the Republicans respond, kind. You Democrats are brainwashed cretins, that's your mental deficit, and your godless secular humanists, that's your moral deficit. In other words, the assumption is on both sides that the opponent is just totally depraved. Not that there could be a disagreement, honest people can disagree honestly, that there could be a middle ground, there could be some, none of that's become less and less and less standard assumption. And you see this all the time. You see this, you know, if you turn television news on, whether it's Fox News or MSNBC or anything else you want to choose, and it's become really, really quite common. It's but a short leap from there to the ad hominem. Are you losing the debate? Shout racist. Liberalism is a mental disease. Gun ownership is a mental health issue. That accuses the other of being mentally and morally unfit. And this is a convergent behavior, although it may spring from different roots. The political scientist Kenneth Minogue has an interesting take on this. The conservatives think that they may be coming from the religious notion of the fall of man. Sin infects all with a total depravity of character. Those on the liberal side may be more secular, but they also think from very different roots in the liberal tradition, which is Minogue's analysis, that the majority of people are callous and hardened, and it's up to a minority to defend the rights of all. So both nominally religious right and nominally secular left seem to adhere to one particular script from the book of Matthew. Enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate, straight means narrow. But wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and may there be which go in thereat, because straight is the gate and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. By the way, that's a scripture that a lot of religious believers don't seem to hold that seriously. You ask most Americans, are you going to go to heaven or going to go to hell? And like 98% say, well, we're going to heaven. But Matthew says kind of the other way around. Newsflash, devil requests stimulus funds to widen the road to hell to meet increased demand. The road to hell is wide and not to heaven narrow. Why is it there's a highway to hell, but only a stairway to heaven? The object then becomes assuming basic depravity among the opposition to attack personal deficiencies at the expense of skewering either the truth content of their ideas or the method of their argumentation. Ad hominem replaces argumentative analysis. There are some distinct aspects here. The core fallacy of ad hominem is to derail discussion of issues in favor of personalities. There's an auxiliary tendency to reduce structural institutional features to personal motivation. Whether we get this from the progressive left, as they like to call themselves, or from the explicitly evangelical right, we're in kind of a sort of scolding, even revivalistic moralism that assumes, first of all, social ills are caused by bad character and evil intent. Secondly, they can be addressed either by personal conversion, bad character to good, or at least depriving the bad people of political influence, short of Bible. And then I use the term revivalism deliberately here. This is a longstanding feature of American Protestant culture carried over in the secular form. That's the progressive left assumes that homicide by firearm is actively fostered by a basket of deplorable characters for whom innocent life is simply there for the taking. That the NRA is composed of gun nuts who all carry their rifles in public and are just waiting for an opportunity to pull the trigger at a shopping mall and cause mass deaths. Kind of hard to caricature this because, I listen to NPR a lot and I read the New Yorker a lot and I get this message constantly. While the more explicitly evangelical right assumes that the legal option for abortion is the doing of remote social elites who are either rebelling against a God-given mandate to protect life or who else actively despise children and want to kill them. Perhaps President Trump's most extreme statement, when the child is born, the mother and the doctor, they wrap it lovingly in a blanket, and then they decide whether or not to execute. What kind of person does that? But that's rhetorically what's floating around is par for the course. There's two different mindsets, but each mindset is equally likely to find ad hominem scolding and appealing tech from different reasons, from different motives, but to the same end. Just as there could be logical fundamentalism, correcter than thou, there can also be logical revivalism, more high-minded than thou. We might wish, thus, beware of the framework of scolding triumphalist moralism that makes ad hominem not so much a logical fallacy as a positive way of life. Okay, so thus ended. Let's look systematically now at various informal fallacies. And you may notice, by the way, in the following example, sometimes multiple fallacies occur. This is not. In what follows, I'm going to walk through the various fallacies, not all of them. Again, my aim. Got a pattern for you. Think about learning verb conjugation. You get a paradigm and then you apply it. Get a paradigm under your belt and you'll have this type of verb, regular, irregular, whatever, and I can go. Mr. Hurley's list is pretty much the standard set of fallacies that all logicians discuss, and every logic book have, a list, more or less the same ones. But there are related bodies of literature that are also important. For example, David Hackett Fisher, who's a major American historian, has a whole book devoted to what he calls historians' fallacies, that is, fallacies that people in his academic discipline are particularly prone. There's also a cognitive bias index from the cognitive psychologists also bears on this topic. So if you want to do some more reading along these lines, be aware that the literature on this kind of thing is not just to be found among logicians, but probably as well. Above all, perhaps it'll be useful to get a grip on standard fallacy names so as not to have merely to reinvent the wheel each time a fallacy is encountered. Schopenhauer, 19th century philosopher, said this: it would be a good thing if every trick could receive some short and obviously appropriate name, so that when a man used this or that trick, he could be at once reproached for it. Well, I guess this suggestion's enough by people who write logic texts. There is a list in every one of them of the sort of names for the tricks that people use. Perhaps Schopenhauer is being overly harsh here. Anthony Flew thinks he is. He discounts what he calls Schopenhauer's false and nasty suggestion that every defect from logical perfection is studied and designing. Well, he commends us nevertheless to learn this lesson. I think Flew has a point. Truth be told, yes, there are times when people deploy fallacies deliberately. There are debaters' tricks. I recall what was said earlier, about the distinction between two types of persuasion, logic, and rhetoric. And if, for example, you're studying to be a trial lawyer, you need to be able to use debaters' tricks and, you know, many things that seem to be fair in court that might not be fair in the philosophy. And of course, people do cultivate this. There are formal debates. You know, there are handlers who school their candidates back to this sort of thing. But we use debaters' tricks, including logical fallacies, to win at any price. Again, I suggested a little earlier, the ad hominem seems particularly common today. Shame your opponent as both morally and intellectually deficient. Flew might be right, but not every logical defect is studied in designing, but so on. There are debaters' tricks in order to construct arguments rather than bad. It's necessary to recognize them for what they are. It's just as important, though, and I said this right at the beginning of today's lecture, to recognize them in oneself as in others. Again, this is not just a game of gotcha. But the reason to recognize fallacies is because they're wrong, and they're destructive, they're pernicious, and you know, you recognize them in yourself for the same reason you recognize them in others, so that they don't get used or they don't pass being called out. All the more reason to take Popper's advice and err on the side of interpretive charity when learning to notice and avoid logical fallacies ourselves. Again, the aim of argument or of discussion should not be victory, but should be progress. Okay, that having been said, now we start with the first group, which are fallacies and relevance. Again, they're different examples, but they have a common thread. All proceed from premises whose relevance to the conclusion is not merely psychological. Remember David Hume, Hume's problem of induction. You say, but I can't live without expecting the future to be like the past. I'm not impressed. You've just given me a psychological fact about yourself. Not the same thing as an epistemological principle or a logical argument, either or both. And remember the similar warning about, that's your opinion. Well, that's just a psychological comment, and that's nothing logical. Okay, first one is appeal to force, argumentum ad baculum. You'll hear some Latin tags. Don't worry about the Latin tags, the English. Argument compels us. We may speak of the force of an argument, but that's different from the use or threat or use of physical force to compel either belief or the semblance of belief in getting people to comply. Peter Strawson says something interesting. When you use an inductive argument, you make a threat. The threat is if you buy the validity of my argument, and if my premises are true, then you must buy the conclusion. And that's exactly how deduction works. We talked about that from chapter one. That's the power of deductive reasoning. But that kind of force, argumentative force, is different than the use of physical force. You can compel somebody to vote your way. Yeah, I see your point. Yeah, point of a knife in his throat. Not quite logical. Of course, if worse comes to worse, Plato and Aristotle. Last night, I used my first argument on my backup to appeal to force. I backed off when I made an implicit threat. This power really controls people. It's great. Yes, many people respond to fear and threats rather than logic. You don't have to have valid arguments to manipulate other people's emotions. Yeah, it works, but ever had a message like this through your email? If you don't forward this to 10 friends, something tragic will happen to you in the next 24 hours. Break the chain. Uh-oh. Yeah, that's an ad baculum. Or the threat of hellfire, including Pascal's famous wager argument. Why should I believe in God? Okay, if I don't believe in God and he doesn't exist, it doesn't matter one way or another, but suppose God exists. Well, and it does matter. If I believe, I get to go to heaven. If I don't believe, I get sent to hell. So the better bet, though more prudent course, is to believe in God just in case. Of course, some religious believers find that a favorable argument. Some would find that not a good argument for the existence of God.
They made him an offer he couldn't refuse.
What was that?
Luca Brazzi held a gun to his head, and my father assured him that either his brains or his signature would be on the contract.
Yeah, the Godfather uses the appeal. What's the difference between God the Father and the Godfather? If God is making you an offer, you can't refuse. Of course, I guess they could do it by email, you know. Rat emoji, frown emoji, dead fish emoji. Because it's perhaps a little friendlier than the kind of overshoes. The appeal to force, argumentum ad baculum, it's a special case of the appeal to consequences, the argumentum ad consequentium. And this is a proof of how this might be done, but the professor says, if P is false, then I will be sad. I do not wish to be sad. Therefore, P is true. But there's a syllogism for you. This is the fallacy that finds a conclusion to be true or false based on whether it has acceptable or adverse consequences. It is a fallacy. It's no way to decide truth value. Don't confuse it, though, with something that sounds similar to consequentialism, which is a position in ethics. Basically, the core of ethical decision-making is to think about the consequences of our actions. That sense of consequentialism is something really quite different from what we're talking about here. Okay, next fallacy of relevance, the appeal to pity. You have our sympathy, but you haven't made a valid argument. Pity can be a powerful emotion, but it is not a compelling reason to act. Here's an example. Former U.S. Representative Gabby Giffords. In 2011, she was shot in the head at an outdoor rally, which left her disabled in speech and thought. Her speech recovered somewhat, and 2 years later, she addressed Congress on the issue of gun control. There's a picture of her handwritten comments, and let's just look at them a little more closely. Thank you for inviting me here today. This is an important conversation for our children, for our communities, for Democrats and Republicans. Speaking is difficult, but I need to say something. Gun violence is a big problem. Too many people are dying, too many children. We must do something. It will be hard, but the time is now. You must act. Be bold, be courageous. Americans are counting on you. Thank you. The content of her appeal is childlike. Rhetorically, perhaps, it's meant to be taken for something that might be called common sense gun control, but logically, it's empty of any specific proposals whatsoever. Think back to the question we asked in chapter one. Is there an argument here? Remember the 5-point checklist. Well, there isn't. There is an admission that it's hard for her to speak, notwithstanding she feels the need to say something. There are a number of assertions. Gun violence is a big problem. Too many children, not sure that's actually the question. But the time is now, be bold. Both unsupported as conclusions and not themselves supporting specific conclusions either, so they're neither conclusions nor premises. Is it an argument? Well, we can check off 3 of our 5 boxes, but we need to check off 5. As a rhetorical strategy, this may work. That is, it tugs at the heartstrings and may, you know, if there were a measure on the floor to vote for some further restriction of guns, that might actually sway some people to vote. Logically, though, it fails. Is there any reason other than pity for her misfortune why Congress might entertain these assertions? Now, what happened to Representative Giffords is unfortunate and especially tragic that her head injury disabled not only her ability to speak, but also her ability to reason. Someone else might try to construct an argument. It might go something like Representative Giffords was injured by gunshot. Children are dying from gunshots. Therefore, restricting guns further will stop gun violence. This could be evaluated on its own merits rather than simply on the basis of pity. Now, this is not a particularly good argument that I've kind of thrown together here from that, but at least an argument is being attempted. You could make it better. You could question the premises. You could substitute other premises. You can work it up. And that's just typically what happens with argument. People do that. They go back and forth and the premises get modified or expanded or whatever till you get a better argument. But with respect to gun restrictions, often they just start with appeals to pity and then they rest there without offering any explicit argument. The Simpsons parody this. This wasn't really directed at the gun debate, but it certainly applies.
Oh, won't somebody please think of the children?
Think of the children. Won't somebody please think of the children?
No, stop. Think of the children.
Think of the children. Oh, won't somebody please think of the children?
Yeah, and then you hear a lot of that. But, you know, what does that actually say? Think of the children. Why? To what end? What are we supposed to think about for the children? And if you think about the children, does that automatically tell you how you should act with respect to and legislation or anything else? Really not. But it sure tugs on the heartstrings. With respect to the rhetorical triangle, we talked about that in chapter one. Field of Pity tries to make pathos triumph over logos, but a logician needs to make logos the central point. One thing to act out of pity, and this may be admirable, here is a tombstone in France of a young captain, Arthur Reginald French, who was killed at the Battle of Aubers Ridge on the 9th of May, 1915, along with his half-brother and 11,000 other people. This was one of those battles in which the generals were fighting the wars that they fought as lieutenants. These troops were ordered to charge out of the trenches into the face of machine gun fire. That is just stupid, militarily stupid, but it happened a number of times during the First War. Generals ordered, officers ordered their troops do that. And this day, one day, 11,000 people died. And French's tombstone reads, pity of it. Yes, that is a pity. Of course, you know, kinds of things happen and they do evoke pity. But one thing to act out of pity, this may be admirable, quite another thing to suppose that pity can substitute for a good reason to act. Does this tell us anything about war? Does this tell us anything about whether wars should be restricted, outlawed, any of that kind of stuff? Maybe yes, maybe no, but it's not altogether clear. There's no argument there, just in pity itself. Pity cannot substitute for good reason. In cases of appeal to pity, the only appropriate response is Hitchens.
I'm still waiting to hear what your point is.
Right.
Still waiting to hear what your point is.
I'm still waiting.
Okay, now we're going to consider a group of appeals that are kind of similar. We can distinguish them. The ad populum, the ad hominem, and the appeal to the person. Appeals to the people, against the person, or to the person. And in the common element, obviously, is the person here. The personal appeals have logical problems. Let's take the bandwagon argument, appeal to the people. Agreeing with a bunch of people who are wrong makes you just as wrong. Something is not necessarily advisable just because it may be popular. Everybody's doing it is not a good reason to act. Yeah, everybody's picking somebody else's pockets, so therefore, I should pick other people's pockets. Well, if two wrongs don't make a right, how about 20? Now, if I agreed with you, we'd both be wrong. Simply because somebody else is doing it doesn't tell me whether it's either wise or right or anything along those lines. Ah, yes, Facebook likes. Being popular on Facebook is like sitting at the cool table in a cafeteria at a mental hospital. Yeah, Alfred E. Newman gives you a thumbs up. The conventional wisdom about bandwagons has shifted a lot. Here's a book from 1841, Extraordinary Popular Delusions and the Madness of Crowd. If you follow the crowd, you are this way, by Man with Wise. A more recent book, 2004, Jim Turowetsky, The Wisdom of Crowds. And you hear a lot of talk about the wisdom of crowds ever since. One of the things the bandwagon does is to undermine something called metacognition. What is metacognition? It's not a household word. But doing this makes us collectively less intelligent and adept, makes us into lemmings. But metacognition, what is it? Metacognition is thinking about thinking. It involves the question, do I know whether I know? To know or not to know is cognition. Metacognition is the second word. Do I know that I know, or do I know that I not know, or do I not know that I know, or do I not know? Don't know. Individuals may or may not have metacognition. Crowds do not. So if I don't know, I don't know, then I think I know. And if I don't know I know, then I think I don't know. All kinds of conundrums here. R.D. Lang in his book on knots takes that up. But fools rush in where angels fear to tread. Not knowing that you don't know can be a dangerous thing. Is the person most lacking in metacognitive self-insight the person most likely to be popular? Imagine this. A debate among three folks, a simpleton, a student, and a professor. Who's going to win the debate? Who's going to win the popular vote? Give you a hint. There's something called the Dunning-Kruger effect. This comes out of cognitive psychology. Dunning-Kruger effect, you probably haven't heard that term again. It's not a household word, but you've probably encountered it. It happens when you're too stupid to know you're stupid. Ever run into anyone like that? They're too dumb to know that they're too dumb. And so, you know, people have a high degree of confidence even when they have a low degree of knowledge. People can have a high degree of confidence also when they have a high degree of knowledge, or people could fall in the middle. They can have a low degree of confidence even when they have a pretty good degree of knowledge. But what happens when low competence meets high confidence? Well, when you're dead, you don't know that you're dead, but it's hard for the people around you. It's the same as if you're stupid.
In order to know how good you are at something requires exactly the same skills as it does to be good at that thing in the first place, which means, and this is terribly funny, that if you're absolutely no good at something at all, then you lack exactly the skills that you need to know that you're absolutely no good at it.
That is kind of funny. From John Cleese of Monty Python, I remember him from the argument.
In other words, if a simpleton, a good student, and a wise teacher were to have a public debate, this is how things could go down. The simpleton knows just a little bit, but is very confident and voices his opinions loud and without hesitations. The student knows more, but doesn't realize it because she lacks confidence. She keeps quiet. The teacher is confident, but understands how complex things really are. Hence voices his opinions with reservations. In the end, the simpleton wins the popular vote because he is so confident about being right, and people tend to trust certainty.
Yes. People tend to trust certainty. Also, they tend to trust volume of output over things like clarity or truthfulness. Sorry, Arthur, your answer was actually correct, but Paul shouted his opinion louder so he gets the point. And an extra bonus point goes to Sue as she was offended by your answer. Ignorance and incompetence breed certitude and self-confidence. Certitude and self-confidence wins the popular vote. Well, not everything's up for popular vote. Science isn't, for example. You know, imagine Larry King interviewing Galileo. Yes, Galileo, but what of the latest poll showing the Earth is flat? Technical skill and competence is not up for popular vote. The smug pilots have lost touch with passengers like us. Who thinks I should fly the plane? Yeah, show of hands. Okay. 50 million Frenchmen can't be wrong. This is a hit song in the 20s and a Broadway musical. This was when prohibition of alcohol was going on in America. And in contrast with the roaring 20s in America, the French were still drinking as usual. And this, you know, this basically was weighing in on that. 50 million Frenchmen can't be wrong. Vox populi, vox Dei. The voice of the people is the voice of God. Well, you know, this sounds good. There are a number of musicals that play on it. Here's one, Les Miserables. The voice of the people, hear the people sing.
Do you hear the people sing? Sing a song.
yeah, it's catchy. You know, you want to fall in line and follow the parade. Notice, by the way, the troops are starting to mass on the side. You hear the people singing the song of angry men. It's the music of the people who will not be slaves again. Hard to disagree with that. When the beating of your heart echoes the beating of the drums, there's a life about to start when tomorrow comes. Yeah, well, the obvious reason why I appeal to the people is going to be problematic is that 50 million Frenchmen can be wrong. During the Second World War, France fell very quickly in 1940, and Philippe Pétain, who was a hero of Verdun in the First World War, took over the government, which was headquartered in Vichy, in the area in gray here you see there, which was part of France that was controlled by that French administration. The other parts were controlled by the Germans, so the Germans set up their headquarters in Paris, and Paris was no longer the seat of the collaborationist French government. Yeah, but that was not a good outcome for lots of Germans. The thing about the Holocaust was it wasn't illegal. It was a legal act under German law, the Nuremberg laws and so forth. Hitler was elected. His voters represented the voice of God. Some people listened over very well at the Nuremberg trials. In 1927 and 29, perhaps 50 million Frenchmen might not have been wrong about partying. In 1932, 13 million Germans, that's more than a third of the German population, voted Hitler for president. Now, Hitler lost that election, but Hindenburg came in first, the hero, German hero of the First World War. But the Nazi Party won enough parliamentary seats, so Hindenburg appointed Hitler Reichskanzler in January 1933. That was when we start dating the 12-year Reich, finally fell in 1945. So Hitler got in by perfectly legal means, electoral processes and so forth. From Paris in 1832, let's go to Berlin in 1932, Life is a Cabaret.
Leafy and green, the Rhine gives its gold to the sea. But somewhere a glory of its unseen tomorrow belongs to me.
Control.
Yes, catchy tune. Little boy starts off a cappella with the song, and then of course it pans away and it looks like he's wearing a Boy Scout uniform, but pans away further and oh, it's the Hitler Youth, and he's singing about, this is a Nazi song, and everybody else in the beer garden knows the words and they all sing along, but it's, you know, kind of caught up in the moment. Incidentally, I know this place. It's the film Cabaret was set in Berlin, but the beer garden you saw there was actually about 5 miles from where I used to live. My family used to go there on Sundays. We didn't sing that song. We were Americans after the war. Okay, but you know, it's a place where people go on Sundays. They take their families and say they have a good time and so forth. And so, you know, these folks are making use of that. The stag in the forest runs free. The babe in the cradle is closing his eyes. All these nice, you know, sort of symbolic, nationalistic images. But the storm is coming, and tomorrow belongs to me. Well, that was 1930-32. Tomorrow belongs to me. They're all marching. The girls also fall in line with the Hitlerjugend. Not much of a future, though, because by 1940, this is where they're beginning to end up. But, you know, the appeal to the people, it's very, very catchy. Yeah? Do they hear the people singing a song of angry men? The music of the people who will not be slaves again. The beating of your heart echoes the beating of the drums. There's a life about to start when tomorrow comes. Tomorrow belongs to me. The future is female, and so on and so forth. Yeah. Tomorrow belongs to me. Well, it's kind of hard to distinguish those two, at least in terms of emotional appeal. What's the difference between the march in Ladies and Robbers and this march in the 1930s as the Germans are reoccupying the Rhineland, remilitarizing? Tomorrow is coming, but who knows? Here's the point, what the voice of the people is going to decide. It seems rather fickle. Now, of course, Vox Populi as an intimate relationship to democracy. Vox Populi, Vox Dei amounts to a standard logical fallacy. The voice of the people is the voice of God. Not always. On the other hand, Vox Populi has to be the rule of thumb for political democracy. Knowing the pitfalls, why would we ever rely on the voice of the people in the first place? Well, here's one sort of answer. Pretty much for the same reason that trial by jury replaced trial by ordeal, you know? Before we hit on the notion of trial by jury, the way we decide things is, for example, witches float. So if a woman's accused of witchcraft, you tie her up, throw her in the river. If she sinks and drowns, well, then she was innocent after all. But if she floats, well, she's guilty. She's a witch. Or trial by ordeal, you know, the accused and the king's representative, or maybe someone in the place of the accused, fight it out with swords. And the one who's left alive, you know, has justice, has law on their side. Pretty inefficient. Trial by jury is inefficient too. You know, 12 votes deciding guilt or innocence may go wrong. There may be a wrongful verdict of guilty. There may be a wrongful verdict of innocence. But given the choices, it's going to be a closer approximation to truth to count hands than it is to rely on the river or the sword or whatever other means you might think of to do a trial. By analogy, the voice of the people may not be unerring either, but what was the alternative? The voice of the king, the voice of the bishops? That's why we hit on that, basically. Winston Churchill puts it this way. The best argument against democracy is a five-minute conversation with the average voter. And democracy is the worst form of government, except for all those other forms which we've tried time to time. In the land of the blind, the one-eyed man is king. There's even a vocabulary to distinguish good democratic opinion from bad, the latter being denigrated as populist. Recognizing that governance needs to answer to something beyond itself, beyond popularity. Law is not a law unto itself, but needs to be weighed against rational considerations, justice included. Martin Luther King, one has not only a legal, but a moral responsibility to obey just laws. Conversely, one has a moral responsibility to disobey unjust laws. I would agree with St. Augustine that an unjust law is no law at all. That is to say, law, the fact that something is legal doesn't make it moral. You know? The fact that persecuting the Jews was legal under the Nuremberg laws does not make it right. Law has to answer in turn to something higher than itself. This is a central issue in modern democracy. We're going to come back to this in another context. Authority, political authority, we're going to talk about this in terms of the appeal to authority, uncalled authority. Authority is what Max Weber called rational legal, that is to say, law needs to answer to reason. It can't just be positive law, apodictic. There's an end on it, no more discussion. Law is not a law unto itself, but it needs reasons and justifications. That's the assumption we make, at least in modern political orders. Thus, if Max Weber and Martin Luther King have their point, pure unbridled populism may not be the last word in democracy. It's a part of democracy, complicated. It's not just a matter of lemmings or people. The famous postcard from France, the election poster is up. La majorité, c'est vous. Vous voulez, vous choisirez. You want, you should choose. Majority, it's you. Well, you know, mom could tell us as much. Just because the cool kids jump off the roof, that means you should. Perhaps not surprisingly, the ad populum appeal to the people fallacy should be common in democracies where the will of the people is valued. Someone studied this in the Croatian parliament. I mentioned this a little earlier. This is what they found. The ad populum was by far the most popular fallacy in parliament. And it even seems there's party preferences, as I noted before, left versus right wing. Left wing really loves overlooking alternatives and really loves ad populum. The right wing really loves the ad hominem and generalizing and the ad baculum, the argument from force. As with any fallacy, the bandwagon fallacy has its limitations. The majority might be wrong, but on the other hand, the majority might be right. Suppose we say the only reason people have sex is because it's so popular. Well, yeah, but maybe there's a good reason why sex is so popular. US is out of alignment with most developed countries on both these items, universal health care and gun prohibition. The US is the only highly developed country that doesn't have universal health care. The US is one of the few that doesn't really, really severely restrict civilian gun ownership. Now, the bandwagon may be bad support, either for universal health care or for outlawing guns, but there may or may not be good reasons for either of these views. That stands to be seen. It would be one thing to argue for universal health care because everybody else is doing it, another to argue for it because universal health care is intrinsically good. It would be one thing to argue that the US should align with Canada, UK, Australia in banning or severely restricting civilian gun ownership because that's the majority position. It would be another thing to argue that it's right to do this because intrinsically right to do so. You want to do it anyway. In each case, the former arguments are fallacious, but the latter are not necessarily. You could make the case on grounds other than simple ad populum. In other words, there's another reason why ad populum is objectionable, and that's the same reason we might object to the appeal against the individual argumentum ad hominem, as well as to unqualified authority, which I mentioned coming to below. Case in point, the 2016 Republican primaries, this is the primary for the nomination. Well, Donald Trump was running on a cult of personality. Just trust me, I'm a winner, I'm a deal maker. You know, I know the art of the deal. I guarantee it, you know. He's appealing to the person himself, which again is a fallacy of relevance. It's irrelevant. I'll be so good at the military, your head will spin. Well, actually, yeah. Marco Rubio, running against Trump, his critique of Trump's policies was text ad hominem. Don't vote for Trump because he's an unmanly wonder. he's got small hands, and you know what they say about men with small hands. Again, irrelevant appeal against the person, whereas Trump was to the person, but he's irrelevant. Appealing to the people or against the person, each is the flip side or the other. Both mistake qualities of persons for the impersonal quality of argument. And, you know, ad hominem comes in as well, which we turn now. We talked a little bit about it as a characteristic fallacy of contemporary politics, but let's look at it in general. Here's a definition. Ad hominem is a specific instance of the genetic fallacy. We can pick that up way at the end. That is to rejecting a claim because of the origins of that claim. And that's genetic, about biological genetics. It's about the origin, genos, the Greek word, in other words, the book of Genesis, the book of the beginnings, that sort of thing. Ad hominem rejects a claim because of the person from whom it originates. That's of a genetic. Podemos dejar nuestro gran país con las manos de un miserable camarón como este? That was basically Rubio versus Trump. And the ad hominems we see on the hierarchy of disagreement ranks rather toward the bottom, just above asshat. But some people take it seriously. You know, would you not listen to a warning about fire because of the political party it comes from? You know, and you say there's a fire, but are you Republican or Democrat? Before I'm going to take it seriously. Here's another example of ad hominem. This is from Saturday Night Live. Dan Aykroyd and think of her name in a minute.
I'm station manager Dan Aykroyd. During the past few weeks in Los Angeles, actor Lee Marvin and his former live-in companion Michelle Triola Marvin have been in court to settle her claim that he owes her half his income from the 6 years they lived together. That is the subject of tonight's point-counterpoint. Jane will take the pro-Michelle Marvin point, while I take the anti-Michelle Triola counterpoint. Jane?
Dan, times change, and so does the nature of relationships. People are reluctant to get married these days, and looking at divorce statistics, who can blame them? But the lack of a piece of paper does not necessarily mean the lack of a total commitment. A woman in this modern-day relationship may well give up all her own personal pursuits, as Michelle Marvin claims she did, to give her full support to her man's career. And Michelle Marvin is just asking that the courts recognize that reality. Dan, there's an old saying, behind every successful man, there's a woman, a loving, giving, caring woman. But you wouldn't know about that, Dan, because there's no old saying about what's behind a miserable failure.
Jane, you ignorant slut. Bagged up, dried up, slunk meat like you and Michelle Triola know the rules. If you want a contract, sign on the dotted line. Oh, but let's all shed a tear for poor Michelle Triola. There was only testimony that she had sexual intercourse over 40 times with another man while living with actor Lee Marvin. But I suppose that sort of fashionable promiscuity means nothing to someone like you, Jane, who hops from bed to bed with the frequency of a cheap ham radio. But hell hath no fury like a woman scorned, and Michelle Triola, like a screeching, squealing, rapacious swamp sow, is after actor Lee Marvin's last $3 million. I guess what you and Michelle are saying is that when you're on your backs, the meter is running. Well, please spare us, gals, and tell us the rates at the top. Then we can choose which two-bit tarts and bargain basement sluts to shack up with.
Ah, the old Saturday night. Yeah, this is back to Monty Python, right? I came for an argument, but I got abuse instead. This is abuse, arguments down the hall, right? But there is actually multiple examples of an ad hominem. And, you know, this is not untypical of kinds of debates you can hear. Okay, here's an algorithm for the ad hominem fallacy. First of all, ignore the arguments. Secondly, attack the arguer instead. Make the arguer look bad, claim victory over the argument, and do a victory dance that last run, optional. Recall our general definition of argument from chapter one. It's linguistic, not anthropological or psychological. It's nothing to do with anger or number of people or any of those kinds of personal things. It's a group of statements, one or more of which supports one of the others. Now, that's to say, in order to evaluate an argument logically, doesn't matter which persons or how many persons or any, whether any persons are involved for that matter. Ad populum, ad hominem, the appeal to unqualified authority, all attempt to skirt this picture. Logic looks at language impersonally. Persons are irrelevant, whether individually or collectively. Two, the linguistic definition of argument explains why that's just your opinion. There's no logical standing whatsoever. Arguments are about the truth value of propositions, not about persons, not about the psychological dispositions. Again, when the sage points at the moon, the fool looks at finger. It's a matter of relevance. If the fact that a statement enjoys popular support, if the fact that a statement enjoys popular support, there's no reason to think it's true. By the same token, the fact that a statement is affirmed by just you is no reason to think it's false. It's kind of the reverse of the appeal to the people. The vast majority of the people make it right, and a single minority of one makes it wrong. Neither of those things. Bragging in the person of the speaker commits not only the ad hominem fallacy, but also that of the red herring. So here again, we have multiple fallacies at once. Distracting from the main issue or changing the subject outright, it's just not cricket. We can call unsportsmanlike conduct here. And back to a referee, we have an ad hominem attack. Personal foul attacked the opponent instead of his argument. Then there's also, in particular, ad hominem abusive. This denigrates the person of the opponent. This is character assassination outright. We find this in a lot of venues. We find this in the criminal law. We find this in political debate. We find this in personal gaslighting of these order. Ad hominem abusive in critical law. With, let's say, stop and identify. Now, in France, for example, in many other countries as well, the police have the right to stop vehicles or pedestrians without probable cause, without reasonable suspicion, and demand their identity papers. I've been subject to France, you know, just pull around a corner and there the police, they have the signs out, they pull you over arbitrarily and search and question. In France, everybody is required to carry a national identity card. In the United States, we don't have this, but if you're a tourist in France, your passport suffices for that. Everybody, of course, foreigners, passport. There are sometimes we may be moving toward that in the United States with the kinds of driving licenses that are needed to fly now cross country, for which a passport is a substitute. But if we're on that road, we're not very far along at this point. In the U.S., it's quite a difference. U.S. citizens are protected by the Fourth Amendment, which prohibits unreasonable search and seizure. Also by the Fifth Amendment against self-incrimination. These are cornerstones of the Bill of Rights. So when American citizens or people in America have contact with police, these fall into three categories. There's consensual, there's detention, there's arrest. Consensual is when the person being questioned is free to go. You can ask a cop, you know, am I under arrest? Am I free to go? You don't want to continue the conversation any further. And if they're not going to put you under arrest, then you are legally free to go. But, you know, you often won't know that until you ask them. And maybe that asking is going to provoke them to do the arrest. You never know about that either. Detention is called the Terry stop after the case Terry v. Ohio. And arrest, of course, requires, at least in this country, probable cause. Not just reasonable suspicion, but, you know, that police genuinely think that you have committed a crime and there was on that basis. Stop and identify applies to category two, detention. In general, if police claim reasonable suspicion, they can question the detainee, but the detainee may also refuse to answer. This is, law is still unsettled here and it varies from jurisdiction to jurisdiction rule. Nonetheless, ad hominem may be invoked against those who do exercise their Fourth Amendment right to privacy against unreasonable search or their Fifth Amendment right against self-incrimination. Mm-hmm. Y'all got something to hide? And you answer yes. Y'all criminal? Well, the right to privacy doesn't seem to be very much in evidence there. And the reasoning seems to be, if you're a criminal, you have something to hide, you have something to hide, therefore you're a criminal. Now, already we should know from chapter one, there's a problem with this. This is poorly reasoned. And if you encounter this, don't let it throw you off your game. Remember the fallacy of affirming the consequent? That's exactly what's going on here. And as a local defense lawyer asserts in one of his commercials, that's true enough, your constitutional right to remain silent only works in your favor if you choose to use it. Now, of course, that can carry a stigma. Former president of the United States, 2016, running for election. The mob takes the Fifth Amendment. If you're innocent, why are you taking the Fifth Amendment? There's something wrong with you if you're exercising what? The Bill of Rights, a guaranteed right. Joseph McCarthy, Senator McCarthy, used to do this back in the 50s, the era, the Red Scare. You come in here and take the Fifth Amendment, and you take advantage of the American Constitution to protect the communist conspiracy. If you use the Fifth Amendment, it proves that you're guilty. Well, that's not what the Bill of Rights says. And this used to be an extremist view with which the courts did not side, and that's why, you know, this example of McCarthy has always been kind of a textbook example, but this is changing. Justice Scalia, late Justice Scalia, Mitchell v. U.S., 1999. If I ask my son whether he saw a movie I'd forbid him to watch, he remains silent. The import of the silence is clear. Okay, you know, Scalia's, you know, not Joseph, wasn't Joseph McCarthy, but someone sitting on the Supreme Court, you know, writing this an opinion that marks definite change in tone. And in 2013, the entire U.S. Supreme Court, Salinas v. Texas, affirmed that a defendant's silence can imply guilt. U.S. v. Long, 2013, same year, upheld a life sentence without parole because the defendant invoked his Fifth Amendment rights. Just as an historical footnote, by the way, August 2022, former President Trump pled. Cops and prosecutors tell their own children, don't talk to the police. There's a book on this. You have the right to remain innocent. James Duane, he's got a number of law schools, some of which are available on YouTube. It's worth a look. You cannot lie to the police. That's a crime. But if you even mention the Fifth, you may harm yourself with the same tenor of some court decisions. What his advice is, invoke the Sixth, instead of the Fifth. Say in no uncertain terms, four words, I want a lawyer. Okay, so you're not lying to the police. You're declaring a willingness to speak to them, but not without a lawyer presence. You're not actually invoking the Fifth. Your lawyer may or may not advise you to do that once you get in there, but get that lawyer in there if necessary. And, you know, that's again what police and prosecutors advise their own children to do. Probably advice. We see ad hominem abusive, of course, as you might imagine, in political debates. See it all the time. Remember that study of the Croatian parliament? Well, in that study, left and right had their own distinctive preferred fallacies. So the left, so to speak, we're going to represent that by a donkey, not the Democratic Party. It's actually a left party, it isn't. False dichotomy, appeal to pity, non sequitur. And the right wing's preferred fallacies, ad hominem, hasty generalization, appeal to force. Well, they have their own respective preferred fallacies. The ad hominem abusive is very common in political debates. Some would say it's even greater today than in the past. One could argue that. But in the US, it doesn't seem to be party specific. You know, the donkeys think that the elephants are mouth breathers, just fell off the turnip truck. Marry their sisters and all that kind of stuff. And the elephants say of the donkeys, you're libtards, you're spineless, you're child killers, you're all. Ad hominem abusive. Does the Democratic Party employ this tactic? Well, here is the classic recent example of that.
Be grossly generalistic. You could put half of Trump supporters into what I call the basket of deplorables. Right?
And the famous basket of deplorables speech. Hillary Clinton is running against Donald Trump in 2016, and maybe it's, oh, I don't know, about 6 weeks before the election. Yeah. And it was possibly cost of the election, who knows? It certainly didn't help. Major party candidates don't mind a blanket denigration of up to half the electorate at a time. And this is not the Democrats alone, this is not Hillary Clinton alone. Mitt Romney did something equally mind-boggling in the 2012 election when he said, yeah, he said this off the record. Hillary Clinton said this, obviously, you know, in a public speech. off the record, he thought he was off the record. It turned out one of the busboys was taping him on camera. 47% of the U.S. population are moochers. They just want free stuff. Okay. Now, I frankly don't understand this. I have to say, this is an electorate, the American electorate, which is pretty much 50-50 divided. Well, this I'm speaking now in mid-November 2022, being the midterm elections. And, it, you know, the vote came down almost to 50-50, both the House and the Senate. So there's maybe a, you know, sort of solid 45% core for each of the two parties, arguing over about 10% in the middle. Why would any candidate in their right mind with those kinds of numbers risk alienating a large segment of the potential voter base by blanket comments like, you know, the other side's just a basket of deplorables, or the other side's a bunch of moochers who want free. I don't understand, but notice both of these folks long. So it goes on. Yeah, so there's Wilbur Wingnut and there's Full Libtard. Bill Maher, I like Bill Maher, watch his show every Friday night. He's always got some interesting folks on, always learning something. But he does this all the time. You know, if you hold an opposing view to his own, you're a wingnut. And that includes Republicans, gun owners, religious believers, fans of country music rather than hip hop, and so on. Orange is the new whack. Yeah? You know, if you're a hunter, it's because you're mentally ill. Richard Dawkins does it as well. It's absolutely safe to say that if you meet somebody who claims not to believe in evolution, that person is ignorant, stupid, or insane, or wicked, but I'd rather not consider that. Being an atheist, he doesn't do that. Why would anyone disagree with Darwin? Only if they're ignorant, stupid, or insane, or wicked. Okay. No room for debate there. Ignorant, stupid, or insane. And the Republicans, of course, do it too. Ben Shapiro, who is a popular speaker in right-wing groups, particularly student groups, and has a lot of his speeches circulating around YouTube. The left no longer makes arguments about politics effectiveness. He says their only argument is character assassination. And so he's out at that. Well, here he is addressing a meeting of the Young Americans for Freedom. This is a Republican student group. And he gives the following astonishing analysis and advice. Let's give.
This is because, unfortunately, people on the right, we like to argue in terms of policies and in terms of information. Folks on the left like to argue in terms of character. And folks on the left love this. This is why Hillary Clinton's entire argument against people on the right is that they're terrible human beings who want to hurt folks, right? This is Hillary's argument. This is Bernie Sanders' argument. Right? Bernie Sanders has no intelligible argument. I'm not even sure he speaks an intelligible language. But what he does say is that everybody who opposes him is a bad person who doesn't care about the poor enough. While playing the air bongos. So if you were debating Bernie Sanders, for example, the first thing that you would say to Bernie Sanders is, Bernie, you like to sit on your high horse and talk about how much people ought to give, what is their fair share. Why is it that you honeymooned in the USSR while it was literally shipping people off to gulags and then killing them? Why is it that you were so okay with the Sandinistas in Nicaragua and you actually made Burlington, Vermont, a sister city to the capital of Nicaragua in the middle of a time when leftist tyrants were murdering people in the streets? Why is that okay with you? What's wrong with you as a human being? Put him on the defense. You have to frame him as a person, right? Because now he knows. He's on notice. It's mutually assured destruction. If he's going to bring a character attack, you're going to bring a character attack, and yours is based on fact while his isn't. So you have to frame your opponent. Rule number three, you have to frame the debate.
Okay. Yeah, so, you know, the right wing argues rationally and on the side of the angels, and the left wing is just out of control on the side of the devil thumbing his nose. Wow. The problem in Shapiro's view is the Democratic Party uses character assassination ad hominem abusive. And what's the solution? Well, the Republicans, who don't ordinarily do this, ought to do exactly the same thing. Bernie, what's wrong with you? Why did you honeymoon in Moscow? Why do you support the Sandinistas? So Ben Shapiro disparages character attack and then goes on to recommend it as a tactic. I find that extraordinary. He attacks Hillary, who did character assassinate her opponent as a basket of deplorables. And then caricatures Bernie, rather than attack Sanders' analysis of the billionaire class versus the 99% or on any other issue, he ridicules him personally. And his reasoning, my opponents do it, so I'm going to do it. When they go low, we go low, so there, yeah, yeah. What is this but a recipe for the perfect race to the bottom? This video clip of Ben Shapiro, I think it's a good illustration of the difference between rhetoric and logic, persuasion by any means necessary, and persuasion by rational means only. Shapiro claims to be on the side of logic, but he shows himself otherwise. Prospect that ad hominem is now an equal opportunity fallacy may reflect a larger issue that ad hominem abusive is now taken not so much as a logical offense, but as a positive way of life. Is scolding now just the default rhetoric? Someone has said, actually this has been attributed to a lot of people, I'm not sure who originally said it. If you aren't a socialist at 20, you have no heart. And if you are a socialist at 40, you have no head. So, you know, the standard sort of democratic line, which Shapiro characters, you're a heartless creature out to hurt poor folks, out to hurt folks, a bad person who doesn't care enough about the poor. I'll play on those. But there's some point to that. And so, you know, the Democrats say that the Republicans have a moral deficit, and the Republicans often, right, that the Democrats have a mental deficit if you're still a socialist by the time you're 40 ahead. But it seems to me there's no monopoly there anymore. Each side criticizes the other for both mental and moral deficits. They just have candidates. So no monopoly there at all. And I suggested earlier on, are we in an age of ad hominem abusive, where that's the sort of standard rhetoric? It certainly runs rampant. Psychopathology, mental and moral deficiency are very, very common. Perhaps the outer reaches of ad hominem abusive in politics is something called the argumentum ad Hitlerum. You know? This is from a German film, Alles wieder da. It imagines what happened if Hitler came back to life in contemporary society. It turns out to run a very, very powerful populist movement in the film. But the reductio ad Hitlerum, you can call it, feels so smart, looks so desperate. Okay, suppose somebody says Hitler was a vegetarian, which incidentally he was. Well, the fact that he was a vegetarian, which is bizarre, but true, is no argument against vegetarianism. We'll come back to this when we talk about genetic fallacy. But there are plenty of arguments about Hitler. First, Bush was Hitler, now Obama is Hitler, and then, of course, Hillary became Hitler, and then Trump, the new Führer, the cover of the news, playing on the German word Führer, leader. Hitler used ad hominem arguments, therefore ad hominem arguments are wrong. Godwin's law, the longer a debate lasts, the more likely someone will invoke Hitler. The corollary to that, whoever says Hitler first loses. But there is a lot of ad hominem abusive, you know, that can't be true because you're an idiot. However, maybe it could be, you know, even the devil can quote scripture, says Shakespeare. We're going to come back to this in the lecture on genetic. And let's consider finally the use of ad hominem in gaslighting, interpersonal gaslighting. The term gaslight comes from a film, 1944, Charles Boyer, Ingrid Bergman, was forgotten. A husband attempts to convince his wife that she's going insane. One of the things he does is he turns on the attic lights in order to cause the gas lights in the living room to dim. That's where the title comes from, gaslighting. He says, you know, the lights are getting dim. And he says, no, you're imagining it. Are you crazy? But he's been causing this and kind of setting her up. And so the term gaslighting came from that film, and we kind of generic. Here's a description of gaslighting. Gaslighters are known to use the following techniques. First of all, lying. Secondly, saying that they never said something, even though there's proof that they did. Thirdly, ramping up snide comments over time and using ad hominem attacks. Fourthly, especially ones that hit close to home, and taking actions that do not match their words, possibly with familiar. As in the original firm, interpersonal gaslighting often is seen as something that men do to women. Think about Jane and Anne Aykroyd. plenty of things in the news. But actually, it's not just confined to men. A classic example possibly comes from Geoffrey Chaucer's Canterbury Tales, way back. The wife of Bath's tale, she says, oh, I'll show you how to manage your husband. First, put them in the wrong. The knowing wife that she is worth her salt can always prove her husband is at fault. So if you think your husband might suspect your adulteries, accuse him of adultery. And, you know, to change the subject and start, you know, getting him worried that even, whether or not he's committing adultery, that you know, he's on the spot, and then he will be less likely to notice you're doing that. That's a gaslighting example. Ages. Beyond gender warfare, gaslighting can also be a recipe for interpersonal power struggle in the workplace. And there's a whole thing on this. I give you the URL down there. When giving instructions, be intentionally vague, then blame the person for not understanding. Collate the numbers. You mean add them? No, collate. And then when they don't work out, wow, you really messed up. The gaslighting version of ad hominem shows up in contemporary discussions of racism. White fragility, why I'm no longer talking to white people about race, because white people are intrinsically microaggressive, have a bias. There's something wrong with them to begin with, so I'm not even going to have a conversation with them anymore. I'm simply going to call out their moral failings. In whatever context, the core of gaslighting is to deploy the ad hominem as a force multiplier to convince the gaslighted to internalize blame. It's one thing to put somebody else on the spot, but it works even better if you can get them to do it themselves on your behalf. Then there's ad hominem circumstantial, and this is a little less firm, I should say. A common strategy is to point out that somebody has or can be expected to have certain self-interest, and therefore what they say could be discounted because they have these interests. This got used against John Kerry, for example, when he was Secretary of State dealing with Israel. Secretary John Kerry wants to curb Israeli settlements. What do you expect? He's not even Jewish. He's no friend of Israel. Or you hear this a lot. That's why, at least my generation, I do. Were you ever in Vietnam? Nope. Then shut up. It reminds me of Vietnam. Were you in Vietnam? No, I mean the Phelps, you know. But you veterans talking with non-veterans if the subject of the war comes up. That's meant to be a trump card in some cases. But did Kerry have good arguments against Israeli settlements? Do non-vets have any good arguments about war or any observations to make about Vietnam? Another fallacious use about hominem circumstantial is guilt by association. Here's a recent example. Donald Trump, of course, got lots of problems and critics, proposed a trump card. A Visa card, I think it was. Was it a Visa card? It had an eagle like that. And then on Twitter, there were all kinds of comparisons. Well, look at Trump's eagle and the Nazi eagle. Aha, say no more. Rest my case, right? Okay, well, you know, there's some similarity between those two eagles, but there's some dissimilarities. Lots of people use eagles for all kinds of symbols, starting with the United States of America. That's, you know, the national symbol. The Boy Scouts of America, its highest award is the Eagle Scout. There's an Eagle Scout badge. Pilots and aviators in the service are given wings that look like wings. British paratrooper badge there shows some wings. Lots of different ways to depict wings. Now, if you just look at the three aviator pilot wings there, the Air Force and the Army don't look much like the Nazi Eagle, but boy, that naval aviator insignia is really close. So are the Navy aviators more Nazi than the Army aviators or the Air Force pilots? Well, that's just silly. You know, that's just silly. Again, whoever says Hitler first loses. Okay, now, ad hominem circumstantial can be fallacious. Other times when it's not, the answer is yes. Here's an example. It's Sinclair. It's difficult to get a man to understand something when his salary depends on his not understanding it, though that is true. For example, there's notoriously a rotating door between industry and those hired to regulate that industry. You know, people go into federal regulation and they come back out and go to work for the corporations that they were presumably regulating a year before. Marcia Angel, who writes about, points out, foxes are not going to be impartial guardians of the medical henhouse if circumstantially their diet consists ends. And so it's not necessarily the ad hominem fallacy, either abusive or circumstantial, to note that a person has vested interests and to argue that those interests actually cause a bias in what they say. Of course, you need to back it up. You need to have some evidence. Mere suspicion doesn't do it. It does have to be argued. Question, what makes the attack on a person fallacious? Well, the answer is when it distracts from or substitutes for consideration of the subject of the argument, when it works as a red herring, when it impedes good reasoning. If there really is a fox guarding the hen house, there's no fallacy to point this out and declare that it's relevant. You know, truth is the ultimate defense against the libel. Thus, for example, a lawyer might impeach the credibility of a witness. Now, the lawyer hasn't shown thereby that what the witness says is false. That is, he hasn't, you know, given an argument there necessarily. But if the witness is an habitual liar, there's reason to impeach his testimony. There's reason not to trust him. You know, once a thief, always a thief. What the witness says might still be established on other grounds or by other witnesses. What the witness says might, in fact, be true. Okay, you can get a true conclusion from faulty reasoning. And from false premises too, for that matter. So that's not a knockdown, but there, you know, it does make sense not to trust somebody whose credibility is suspicious. And once again, it's important to think about what's fallacious and why, rather than just delivering a knee-jerk verdict, rather than just putting on somebody like the fallacy police. He says, because you smell bad, I don't trust this soap you're selling. And she says, because you smell bad, I'm not voting for your party candidate. Well, you know, one of these is fallacious, the other is not. I wouldn't buy soap from somebody who doesn't smell like they've been using soap. We've been using the soap, especially if they've been using it. We're going to take this up in lecture part five. Is that emotive versus cognitive meaning. Is a matter of not letting rhetorical pathos overcome logos. Here we have the parallel problem of not letting ethos overcome logos. Mr. Hurley distinguishes between rejecting an argument as fallacious and rejecting testimony or credibility as not fallacious. They used to say, Richard Nixon, would you buy a used car from this man? Is this the sort of person that you could trust? Does he strike you as trustworthy? And if not, are you going to believe what he tells you about bombing in Vietnam or anything before that particular incident? Sometimes it does matter that a person has a bad character. If Jack truly is an habitual liar, is it wrong to be especially skeptical of what he's? And again, I don't think that, you know, the cautions against the argument of ad hominem, including the circumstantial, are meant to preclude any, you know, whole range of sensible things. They're meant to make us stop and ask questions. We do have to think. It's not an automatic knee jerk. Okay, tu quoque is another argument against the person, sometimes called the hypocrite fallacy. Just because someone is a hypocrite doesn't negate the point. Tu quoque turns a personal criticism back against the criticizer. Perhaps it should be called the Idaho fallacy or the hypocrite fallacy. It combines the ad hominem with the red herring in an accusation of hypocrisy. Special instance of the ad hominem. And tu quoque, this is one for which we use the Latin, we don't always retain it. Hey, have you got kids? Well, you've probably heard this one or a version of this one. Hey, mom, you tell us smoking is bad for our health and you smoke, you hypocrite, right? Well, smoking is bad objectively for your health if you do it a whole lot. And that's true even if mom is also a hypocrite. Yeah. This is a favorite among teenagers, you know, and other children. You did it first, you know. But not only teenagers and small children, some big children too. You know, she says, you smoke like a chimney, stop. And he says, oh yeah? Well, there have been more sailors through your bed than through the Panama Canal. Doesn't this amount to saying, I don't have to improve until you get perfect? Well, okay. Maybe smoking is bad for his health, no matter who she is. Voltaire reminds us, perfect can be the enemy of the good, implying that it shouldn't be. Sometimes tu quoque takes the form of a simple accusation of hypocrisy, do as I say, not as I do. Sometimes it takes the form of offsetting penalties. Yeah, I do X, but you do Y, which is worse. I don't have to prove to you you're perfect. Oh, you see this among couples. Your washing's on the floor. It's not in the way. It never gets washed. Yeah, plenty of clothes, you know, back and forth and back and forth. You know, you're wronger than I am. Here's an excellent practical reason to study logic and understand fallacies. People you know and love are going to scream hypocrite at you a lot in order to excuse their own self-destructive behaviors, but you're educated. Call them out on this sort of thing. You know, point out that the two-stroke way doesn't really hold water. Here's a practical example of how this gets used in court. Klaus Barbie was an SS officer known as the Butcher of Lyon. He was in charge of the Gestapo there, personally supervised torture as the chief of the Gestapo. He was also responsible for executing the French resistance leader, Jean Moulin. He's a really bad guy. Finally came to justice in 1984. They caught up with him years later. His lawyer, Jacques Vergès, gave the Tukwokwe defense for him and said, basically, you French people did it too. Yeah, gentlemen, my client did nothing worse in France than French General Massieu did in Algeria before. France has no right to try him for war crimes. This justice, you call it, as merely victor's justice, right? The victors write the history. They also judge the vanquished by their laws, by the vanquished laws. Okay, so does this really carry any weight? The Germans did a lot of atrocities during the war as a matter of policy. Here's one. A lot of Americans don't know this, but practically every Frenchman does. The village called Ourdes-sur-Glan. It's in Poitou, near Poitiers. 1944, the Waffen-SS herded the women and children into a church, the men into barns, and then set 643 people on fire. This is what the village looks like today. They left it just as it was. There's a burnt out car. There, you know, sewing machines still sitting in houses, burnt out. The church is burned out. And, you know, the Nazis just walked off. They, of course, they were in control of the country, so no investigation was mounted. There was no police force to deal with them. Later on, after the war, you know, there was some discussion of it. In the German village of Gardelegen in 1945, as the war was coming to a close, German troops used the same tactic to massacre about 1,000 concentration camp prisoners in a barn. This time they got caught because the American forces were advancing, and there's a picture down at the very lower left. The civilians from that village are forced by the American soldiers to take the bodies out and give them proper burial and, you know, to face what the German troops had done. And then there was this network of camps. You may have heard of some of them, things like Auschwitz, Birkenau, Buchenwald, Dachau, and that thing. This was very systematic on the part of the Germans. Were there atrocities on the other side? Well, let's look at the clip from Saving Private Ryan. Yeah, I was for supper. Now, the context is, this is D-Day. These troops have just come off the beach where it was a murderous beach, Dog Green Sector. The Germans had it pre-sighted with machine gun or artillery fire and just tore up the troops. But those that made it up to the top, eventually did, were really, really angry at the defenders. Private Ryan is, although it's based on a true story, any of the events that you see in here is all fictional, but these kinds of things did happen. So, you know, imagine, you know, you're in a situation where these were Czech conscripts in the German army. They were speaking in Czech, trying to surrender. And, you know, and by the laws of war, Geneva Convention, all that, if they're unarmed and attempting to surrender, you know, they have to be treated humanely. But these guys laughed about it. No doubt this kind of thing went on. The next clip we're going to see is from Band of Brothers. This is based on an actual documented event. Lieutenant Spears in question here did not face justice for this, but quite probably he did what's depicted here.
That's when I was at Monarch tooling propeller shafts. No kidding. What are the chances of that, huh? You and me, 100 miles from each other, working practically the same job.
An American soldier and a German soldier.
We're waiting on you.
Yeah, I'm coming. I gotta run. I'll see you around.
Yeah. See you around. Cigarette?
Here you go.
Up in my fire? Thank you.
Danke.
Thank you.
Shit. Easy company?
Summary execution of prisoners who have surrendered. Clearly illegal. So these sorts of things, yes, no doubt, went on, that one in particular. Okay, so do Allied combat atrocities excuse Axis war crimes? Well, this is what Barbie's lawyer argued they did. And we heard the same sort of claim in Nuremberg right after the war, 1946. Of the four victorious Allied powers who conducted the trial, United States, the USSR, France, and Britain, France and Britain had given away Czechoslovakia. France had a collaborationist government. We talked about that. USSR allied outright with Hitler in the first 2 years of the war. Hitler turned on them, and then they joined the other side, Russians, Soviets. Was it therefore unjust to try the Nazi war criminals because the victors had blood on their hands and were tainted? There's a term for this political use of two court ways. It comes from Soviet times. It's called whataboutism. And the Soviets would, you know, constantly say when they were accused of atrocities, well, you know, look how you Americans treat your Negro population. You lynch Negroes. In those days. Whataboutism is a, you know, remains a common tactic. Even though there's no use. So does this mean it's fallacious simply to cite counterexamples or to look at other sides? What makes whataboutism fallacious is not that it seems to say, look at the other side of the coin, which is a fair thing to do, but that it leaps instantly to the counterexample, but away from the example at hand, and acts as a kind of red herring, as well as tuquoque. So on several grounds. Tuquoque, known as the hypocrite fallacy, often it occurs when someone notes that there's deviance from norms. The conclusion is there cannot have been those norms in the first place. For example, in the 1940s, Robert Merton, famous sociologist, propounded four norms of science. The science is characterized by norms of universalism, communism, disinterestedness, and organized skepticism. Okay? That is, scientists cooperate universally with each other and they seek universal truths. They do so in common. That's the communism. That's the thing. Our Marxist-Leninist. They're disinterested, they want to find the truth no matter, you know, what. And they are skeptical, but in an organized way, they're constantly criticizing, you know, each other's work, trying to we talked vis-a-vis Popper and that sort of thing. Okay, so the hypocrite fallacy, when someone notes that there's a deviance from norms, the conclusion is that there cannot have been norms in the first place. And people say this about the norms of science. Look at how they operate, because they don't, at least not completely. There's government secrecy and non-disclosure. The scientists working for the US were not able to communicate with the scientists working for the USSR during the Cold War. Private firms hold patents. Increasingly, big science is done outside of universities, it's done in corporations. Big pharma pays to play. There's a lot of abuse of these two norms, in particular the first two, universalism and communism, such that some people would say that's not even an abuse of norms, it just goes to show that there weren't those norms in the first place. But this misses a big point. As the Rocher quote said, hypocrisy is the homage vice pays to virtue. It's the very force of the norms, you could argue this, which allows critics to call out big pharma and to shame science for being in bed with the military industrial complex. In science, whenever data faking is detected, it is severely punished, by the retraction of publications, even by the retraction of academic degrees. This happened to this guy, Andrew Wakefield, for example, who claimed that vaccines caused autism. And there's still people that say that based on one piece of research by him that was published in The Lancet, which is the prestigious British medical journal, like our journal of the American Medical Association here in this country. When the fraud was discovered, the text was retracted, he lost his degree. There have been no other studies that have said that, have come to that same conclusion, although there is a movement continuing to fight as if it's research. But yeah, the norm is in science. When fraud is detected, it's pretty severely punished. There are some very clear norms at work there. Martin Luther King was a grandmaster at not getting trapped by too quickly. His political genius. Again, hypocrisy is the homage that vice pays to virtue. Was it hypocritical that the American founding father who wrote all men are created equal, Thomas Jefferson, himself owned other human beings as property? Yes, of course it was. And this gets pointed out quite a lot. Now, one response to this is to say, okay, and therefore, you know, the 19 Project, racism has been baked into the American project from the very beginning in 1619. That was not Martin Luther King's response. He had a very different response, interesting one. He used the fact of hypocrisy dynamically. He says, yeah, okay, Jefferson was a hypocrite, but I'm going to hold him to his word. If all men are really created equal, prove it. You know, with consequences. King figured out that hypocrisy is a teeter-totter. It's inherently unstable, but it could be moved in a desired direction rather than just condemned. You know, one can appeal to a hypocrite, at least some hypocrites, to choose the better angels of their nature, as Lincoln said. This would never be possible with a total cynic. Which is why, for example, George Orwell pointed out about Gandhi. Well, yeah, Gandhi was able to sway the British Empire. Hypocrisy is the distinctively British vice. Could Gandhi have achieved what he achieved if it had been Hitler instead or the Japanese Empire? Probably not. Not everyone has better angels to their nature. There is a future possible world in which the Middle Kingdom overlords, Middle Kingdom is China's name for China, are going to be tone deaf to any such appeal because they lack entirely the hypocrisy which rests on any prior foundation of human rights. I'm going to come back to this notion the very, very, very last lecture in this. In the early video clip, Ben Shapiro uses not only ad hominem abusive, but also to quoque, we writers choose personal attack. Well, you left us did it first. Once again, multiple fallacies may occur simultaneously. So to summarize part one of the lectures on fallacies, informal fallacies. The definition of fallacy is any defect in an argument other than false premises, and it can be formal or it can be informal. Fallacies are fallacies only insofar as they impede good reasoning. So it's important not to reject this, to a game of gotcha. And also detecting fallacies requires some thought. It's not mere knee-jerk. And there will always be limits to fallacies. Informal fallacies can be organized into groups, relevance, weak induction, presumption, grammatical analogy, and ambiguity. We started with one relevance. Elements. So, thank you for listening. This has been Michael Cavanaugh. Good day.